Assalamu alaikum, brothers and sisters. Welcome to tonight's talk, which is entitled The New World Order. It will be presented by Dr. David Pidcock and Professor Ken Palmerton. Dr. Pidcock was born in Sheffield in 1942 and embraced Islam in 1975. He's a founding member of the National Association for Victims of Fraud and Banking Malpractice and the leader of the Islamic Party of Britain. He presents his arguments with a wealth of authentic source material and in an enlightening and humorous style without any fanaticism. Professor Palmerton is the Vice Chairman of Christian Council for Monetary Justice and is Director of the Institute for Rational Economics and also is a former Freemason who is now a Christian. He is also a lifetime member of the Liberal Democrat Party and, as he likes to put it, he is a professional toolmaker. The talk will last for approximately 1 hour 20 minutes, followed by a 20 minute question and answer session. If brothers and sisters could write the questions on a piece of paper in front of them and then pass the questions down to the front, please. And I would like to hand you over to Dr. Pidcock to begin.
Thank you. Assalamu alaikum. I've been promoted. I'm not a doctor. I wasn't before I came to Leicester, but I didn't realise you could get a degree so quickly these days. Assalamu alaikum. Shalom alaikum. Peace be with you. The talk, The New World Order, is something that we have covered on a number of occasions, I think probably in Leicester as well, but not for some time. And since we were last here, we have managed to gather much more information that, inshallah, you will find useful, we hope. Before we start, the usual problem, or the usual situation that attends these sorts of discussions about conspiracies and the New World Order usually descend into slanging matches, and they have been in the past. What I want to establish right at the very beginning, that what we are covering in no way constitutes anti-Semitism. I say that right at the beginning because I come from an ecumenical family, let's say, one comprised of Muslims, Jews and Christians, not many Jews, two in fact, but converts to Judaism, as a result of which I've managed to gather over the years a lot of information. Now, if we refer to the Quran and the Hadith of Rasulullah, we will find that amongst the people of the book, there are people who are trustworthy and those who are not trustworthy. Now, this also can apply to Muslims as well. We all have our pet stories about things that have happened, that Muslims have become, as Rasulullah said, Zabd al-Bah, and the weakness of the Muslims indicates their condition and their situation in the world. So, what I want to establish from the beginning is that there are, amongst the Jewish community, those who endorse whatever we're going to say tonight, even though it may be against the State of Israel, even though it may be against certain ideals that people have. But, for instance, we have here four eminent rabbis. Can you see that? Is it fairly clear to read? These are members of the Natura Carta. These are the guardians, and they, in fact, two of them are members of the PLO. So you find here there are certain amongst the Jewish community, as Allah says, there are amongst them those who, if you trust, give a piece of gold or something to trust with, that they will return it, as amongst the Christians. They are fully in support of the Palestinians. They know that the State of Israel should not exist until the coming of the righteous Messiah, Moshiach, the Messiah. They know that the State of Israel, according to them, is a blasphemy, and that it should not exist because they were kicked out of Palestine, out of the Holy Land, because of their unholiness. Now these rabbis, and there are quite a number in this country, was very outspoken, Rabbi Schoenfeld. In 1929 he made this statement that the Jews do not want in any way to take what isn't theirs, and they certainly do not want to contest the rights of the other inhabitants to the places held by them, which they regard with honour and consider holy. And in particular, there is no foundation that, to the rumour that the Jews want to acquire the Temple Mount. On the contrary, from the time that, because of our sins, we were exiled from our land, and our holy temple was destroyed, and we have been lacking the purity required by the Torah, it is forbidden for any Jew to set foot upon the Temple Mount until the coming of the righteous Moshiach, or the Messiah. Ariel Sharon is not the righteous Messiah. Aerial bombardment, as he's better known amongst the Palestinians and Lebanese, of course we're aware of what he's been up to over the years. But these rabbis, these scholars, two of which, if you remember the return of Yasser Arafat in 1994, I think it was Rabbi Moshe Hirsch, was appointed a foreign minister with the PLO, and follows in this tradition of those who acknowledge that Leviticus, the book of Musa, alayhi salam, says that because you have defiled the land, it will spew you forth. Now, the destruction of the state of Israel happened on the same date, the 9th of Ab, in the time before Christ, and in 70 AD it happened on the same date. According to the scholars and the Torah code, that they reckon that the state of Israel, the present state of Israel, will be destroyed this year or by the year 2012, according to their own prophecies. So this is because the state of Israel as it exists is not the state of that would be acknowledged by any prophet. It is the state of Dajjal or Antichrist, because Ben Gurion said he didn't believe in God, but on the contrary thought God believed in him. So that is the attitude of the first Prime Minister of Israel, who definitely was an atheist and had no interest in the religion of Musa alayhi salam. For instance, until 6 months ago, Richard Ingrams in The Observer made a very interesting observation about his friend AJP Taylor, a very famous professor of history. And he said, he quoted AJP Taylor and the problems that he had and many others have had, honest people who try to raise the issue of that there is a difference between Zionism and Judaism, and there's also a difference between Orthodox Judaism and Rabbinical Judaism, and also this particular group who are Torah conscious. They accept that the Torah is the revealed book. The majority amongst the community, maybe 75%, don't believe in God. The other group believe that the 70 elders who attended Musa alayhi salam on Mount Sinai got the real message and Musa got the wrong scripture. So I'm trying to set the scene to show that what we're about to say, we have to be discerning and differentiate between those who are Torah conscious Jews, those who accept the Torah, who believe that the present state of Israel is contrary to the Torah, contrary to their order to stay out of Israel, to stay out of Palestine until the Messiah comes. Now, this brings us to another point. The righteous Messiah for Bani Israel was Isa, Jesus, peace be upon him. The fact that they missed or left him out the last time, they will finally come to the conclusion and realization that Isa is the righteous Messiah. And of course the Muslims are waiting for the second coming, the return of Jesus, peace be upon him. And so there is much in common between certain people amongst the people of the book, the Jews and the Christians, who understand that that Islam is not the problem, it's part of the solution. The importance of hadith, prophecy, for Muslims as well, of course, is highly important, because we know from the Torah, from the prophecies in Deuteronomy, that Allah would send a messenger exactly the same as Musa alayhi salam, and he would put his words in his mouth. This prophet, who was to come and has come, would make prophecies till Yawm al-Qiyamah. There is extremely important data, inshallah, that over the past 25 years I've been working on trying to do analysis relating to historical fact and the prophecies of Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam. One very important piece of information came about 20 years ago, and since then I pieced together what I think is a correct interpretation of this particular hadith, which is very important in my opinion. On this side here, you will see that there is a hadith related in Sahih Muslim. It's also contained in Mishkat. And here we see that Abu Huraira reports that Rasulullah said, "The last hour shall not occur till 70,000 sons of Ishaq will attack the city which is on the sea," understanding him to mean Constantinople. He said, "The last hour shall not occur till 70,000 sons of Isaac will attack it, but when they come, they will not fight with arms or shower it with arrows. They will simply say, 'There is no God but Allah, and Allah is the greatest,' and one of its sides will fall. They will recite it for a second and a third time, and it will be opened unto them, and they will enter it, and they will gather the spoils of war. And then a proclaimer will come and say, 'Verily, Dajjal has come out.' And they will return." In Mishkat, the same hadith is also reported with an additional few lines which are extremely important historically. He said, "Within 6 years, look to the great war, Jihad Akbar. Then, after one more year, the emergence of Dajjal and revolution which will enter every Arab house, followed by mutual hatred and hostility between the Arabs." We know from the evidence now from the British ambassador, the Times History of the War, and over 168 publications from September 1908, that this event took place on the 8th of July 1908. If we look at it from the timetable that Rasulullah mentions, if we add 6 years to 1908 July, it brings us exactly to July 1914, which is the beginning of the Great War. If you look on any of the monuments, the obelisks, the Masella, you will find to the glorious dead fallen in the Great War. So the Jihad Akbar is the term that Rasulullah uses exactly in this hadith. And we call it, if you read any of the British histories, you'll see it's called the Great War. Exactly the term that Rasulullah uses. 1914 is when it begins, exactly 6 years to the day. Then he says, skip 1 year. Then after one more year, the emergence of Dajjal. So 1914, the year after 1914 is 1915, which you leap and you go to 1916, which brings us to the Arab revolt headed by Lawrence, T. E. Lawrence, Lawrence of Arabia, which begins by August of that year. Now, very interesting again. Here we have, from the Times, the 20 volumes that I have of the Great War. This is showing the Hijaz flag. But here on the right, you will see that in the Hijaz itself, in 1914 and to 15, no outward sign of revolt was there. And Rasulullah says, skip 1 year. The Arab revolt begins in the August, beginning of September, in the year of 1916, exactly in the timetable given by Rasulullah. Now, what is... So here we have non-Muslim scholarship. This is actually reporting from the times of the period. And we have here a very important piece, a confirmation, that says that this hadith of Rasulullah has to be taken very seriously. This is a letter sent by from the British Embassy in Constantinople. And it was on the 10th of 29th of May 1910. And here we see that this is the British Embassy reporting to from Sir Gerald Lowther to Sir Charles Harding the makeup and the nature of the Young Turk Revolution. The Young Turk Revolution, he's pointing out, is actually been the work of the movement from Salonika, which is an entirely Jewish movement. The important thing is there that 80,000 of those, the Jews in Salonika, were from Ishaq. They are Semitic Jews. There are 20,000 from the sect of Shabbat Zvi, who were people like the Ashkenazi who converted to Judaism and then apparently converted to Islam, but only on the surface. So the important number here is to see that these are 70,000 sons of Ishaq, and they are known to be from the Sephardic community. There's no doubt about that. And Sir Gerald Lowther is pointing out here, as you'll see, that basically it was an entirely Masonic movement. The whole system was of Freemasons, and the group in Salonika, they had lodges that were there under French and Italian control. And the whole operation for the takeover of the Ottoman Empire was engineered through Salonika. It was financed by the banking house of Jacob Schiff in Wall Street, and it was funded and financed, as was the Bolshevik Revolution, through the same banking houses. In fact, Trotsky, for 3 months prior to the revolution in 1917, was staying with Jacob Schiff in Wall Street. So here we have a very interesting link with Wall Street and the fact that there was a policy to obtain Palestine by stealth, and beginning with, of course, undermining the whole of the Turkish Ottoman Caliphate and the administration. By the end of July of 1908, this secret society took control of the Ottoman administration. Javed Bey, all the administrators, the heads of the army, everything, eventually all of them were governed by this group of Freemasons, Masonic Jews, some professing to be Muslims, but in actual fact this was the total movement was engineered and financed out of the City of London and out of Wall Street in America. From the times, you see, this would be a group in Salonika. The entire city of Salonika was stopped on the Sabbath, on the Shabbat. On the Saturday, everything stopped. So it was for 400 years an entirely Jewish community operated and controlled through the various synagogues, but mainly through the Masonic lodges. And the letter, the full letter of Sir Gerald Lowther, that we have now from archives It's about 8 pages to 10 pages long, and it gives us all the names of the people, including a mention of Jacob Schiff, the financier. The army, then the Turkish army, there was the massacre of Armenians. 1.5 million Armenians were massacred. Now the Turks or the Muslims have been blamed for this massacre. In actual fact, the administration, the army, the whole administration was then under Zionist control. And Turkey is still today, if you notice, has very strong links with the Zionist state, and it always will have, because people like Tansu Çiller, who was a former prime minister, is a donma. So she was wearing her Islamic tarbush, or whatever it was that ladies wear at times. So the administration there is the one that was installed in 1908, and it is still operating to this day, totally secular and against the interests of everybody, including the rabbis, as they've admitted that it was far better under Ottoman rule than it was ever under this secular Zionist rule. Another interesting piece of evidence is that you see here, this was a picture of Medina in 1916. At that time it was a walled city. At the time of Dajjal, according to a hadith, the city of Medina would have 7 gates. It has no gates now. But this was a city at the time that had gates. We're still waiting to get the architectural plans. People have promised us these, but at least we know at this time this city was a walled city. It is no longer a walled city. It's almost completely destroyed by the Saudis, basically beginning with the destruction in conjunction with lots of other people. They basically decimated the whole of Medina as it was in the time of Rasulullah. Everything's been erased. There's nothing there. Only things that actually relate to the present Saudi regime exist. Everything else has been flattened. So we have problems on not only in Turkey but other parts of the Islamic world. To go back to the information about the Ottoman the information from the Masonic archives of the period, which tell us that in the Arcadia magazine, it's all actually in this book that's been prepared. There are some here that you can look at and acquire if you wish. In October 1908, the Masonic newspaper in Istanbul published the following article in its newsletter, which was called Arcadia. A secret Young Turk Council was formed, and the whole movement was directed from Salonika. Salonika, the most Jewish town in Europe. 70,000 Jews out of a population of 100,000 were specially suited for the purpose. Now here we have 70,000, and exactly the number Rasulullah mentioned is 70,000. So it isn't, when he says something, it's precision. And then he goes on to say that these basically it already contained several lodges in which revolutionaries could work without being disturbed. These lodges are under the protection of European diplomacy, and as the Sultan was without weapons against them, his fall was inevitable. Now we know from archive material now what happened, that the Sultan had cannons, he had howitzers, he had rifles, but they had no ammunition. So by stealth, by the sleight of hand, and by the operations of the secret societies, he was basically powerless, and therefore, as the Arcadia magazine says, his fall was inevitable. And Rasulullah says, they will come, they will not fight with arms or shout with arrows, they will simply say, there is no God but Allah, and Allah is the greatest, and it was open to them. So this is the sort of data that we have managed to piece together from these non-Islamic sources. So at least people can't accuse us of actually tinkering with the information. Now here we have a very important additional piece of evidence about the engineering of the takeover of Turkey. Here we have Theodor Herzl from his own diaries, and he's saying here on the 17th of June 1896, Nevelinsky believes that the Sultan's only salvation lies in an alliance with the Young Turks, who for their part are on good terms with the Macedonians, Cretans and Armenians, and in putting through reforms with their help. He had given this counsel to the Sultan. I, Theodor Herzl, said that in addition to this program, he should provide with Jewish help the means to carry it out. Let the Sultan give us that parcel of land, Palestine, and in return we will set his house in order, regulate his finances, and influence world opinion in his favour. Saddam Hussein could actually get a good press if he actually played ball with these guys. So it's all down to media. An additional piece to that is how he was going to finance it. Because it's all down to understanding that the power of the system is in the money. If you are not in control of the creation and the distribution of money, then basically you are powerless. You can have men on the moon or in space or like Russia, but they are powerless because the power is in the money. Here we have how Herzl was going to actually do the deal with the Sultan. Unprepared as I was, I merely said to him that we were figuring we would give some £20 million for Palestine. We devote £20 million Turkish pounds. I said, so here we go. He understood money. And the key to understanding that the caliphate was in difficulty because they were in debt to the French and British banks. And as soon as you're in debt, then you are wide open for takeover. So, again, we have to know how the game is played, and until we are in control of our own money supply, which is the whole argument over the single currency, I digress a bit, but the power is in the sovereignty over the issuing of money. If you relinquish that right, you are powerless. And Lord Stamp, who was a director of the Bank of England, here I quote him below, banking was conceived in iniquity and born in sin. Bankers own the earth. Take it away from them, but leave them with the power to create credit, and with a flick of a pen they will create enough money to buy it all back again. Take this power away from them, and all the great fortunes like mine would disappear, and they ought to disappear. For then this world would be a happier and better world to live in. But if you wish to remain the slaves of bankers, and pay for the cost of your own slavery, then continue to let bankers control money and control credit. Having achieved the fall of the caliphate, the next move by Jacob Schiff and the Zionist movement, who remember are atheists, 99.9% have no belief in God, only a belief in real estate. And this is interesting, in the bottom right hand corner here, we'll see what Jacob Schiff was saying. He said of the financial of the Russian Revolution, he said, I believe I'm not far wrong if I say that 50% to 75% of the so-called Jewish nationalists are either atheists or agnostics, and that the great majority of Jewish nationalist leaders have absolutely no interest in the Jewish religion. Edwin Montagu is the one who quoted that in regards to the Balfour Declaration. Now, if we look again and see, we see the same pattern emerging in the Russian Revolution, which was, remember, followed almost immediately on the heels of this Young Turk movement. And here we see the leaders of and the founders of that revolution. Trotsky, Bronstein. Lenin, his Ulyanov, was not his real name, it was actually Goldman. And Trotsky, for 3 months, as I mentioned earlier, was staying in with Jacob Schiff in Wall Street prior to the Bolshevik Revolution. And Reverend George Simmons, who was the superintendent in St. Petersburg until October 1918, mentions that in December 1918, out of 388 members of the revolutionary government, only 16 happened to be real Russians. All the rest were international Jews, with the exception of one US Negro. 265 of these Jews came from the Lower East Side of New York. And such has been the condition of affairs in Russia from that day to this. So there were only 16 Russians in the first Bolshevik government. The entire shipment went with the blessing of President Wilson, who gave Trotsky American passport, $10,000, and the ship sailed, but was stopped by the British Navy off Halifax. And was Baruch ordered the British to release the vessel and allow it to continue, otherwise the stock market would be manipulated once again, as it happened later. But the threat was, unless we release them, that basically we would have serious troubles. And that was, it's well documented in the Balfour Lansing correspondences. So this is the power behind the revolution. Again, this is more evidence, again from the various documents. This is from the Jewish Communal Register in New York, and talks about the firm of Kuhn and Loeb, headed by Jacob Schiff, floating the large Japanese war loans in 1904 to 1905. And basically this is how Russia was engaged. Japan was financed and brought to challenge Russia, to weaken Russia, because this was part of the plan. Because remember that unless you're planning, things don't go just by hope. You know, the IBM system, inshallah, bukara, bil mishmish, you know, IBM, you have to plan, things have to be arranged. And basically we see here that Jacob Schiff was the one who was identified as the main financier. And more information and evidence comes in support of this. And we can see the degree of influence, for instance, in the group that were then also engineering things prior to the United Nations, because Rasulullah also predicted that when Dajjal, because this is the Dajjal system, fails to bring the world under his control through his machinations and his false beliefs, the Christian nations will gather under 80 banners to try and bring peace in the world, but would in actual fact betray the world and bring about its destruction. So the League of Nations, those from Pakistan or India will know what Iqbal had to say. He called it a League of Thieves, and he was absolutely right. This was the group that preceded, and you can see that the influence, even after the time of Stalin, later, practically all of them were like the Donmer. You had these people masquerading under Christian names or different names, but in actual fact were from the same group, this cabal that actually were engineering the overthrow and the expropriation of Palestine by any means, fair or foul. There are a couple of other things I'll show you in support of this. I'll come to this later, but this is from the Masonic Encyclopedia, Coyle's, it's a famous encyclopedia. And here we can see here, in 1820, Kushlev was elected Grand Master and advised the Emperor that the organization of Freemasonry was a danger to the state. And Alexander issued at Naukas an edict closing all the Masonic lodges, and it was renewed by his successor Nikolai I. And it said that secret gatherings continued until 1830. Basically, this was repealed by Kerensky. Now, the mild revolutionary. Kerensky was again another Donmer. He was wearing his different hat. But Kerensky, as the Masonic Encyclopedia said, subsequently found asylum in the United States and was living there until 1959. As you'll find, many of the revolutionaries, they went to and found very good living in America. Now, the second part of this statement from Quoyle's Encyclopedia is Romania. In 1920, Universal Freemasonry, or the Grand Orient of America, opened a lodge in Romania called the Jacob Schiff Lodge. And remember this name, Jacob Schiff, it'll come up again shortly. And you have to see that history keeps repeating itself. Because here we have another famous Schiff. This lady here is Al Gore's daughter, who is married to Paul Schiff, the Wall Street banker, from the same dynasty. So right up to today, you have the same group. They're always working very well. They have an objective, and they work to an objective. So here we have here Karenina Schiff, the oldest daughter, and the closest advisor to Al Gore. So here we have some interesting things to draw together. Why Al Gore was in Malaysia, calling for democracia and liberacion and all these things, and supporting the Anwar's case, when in actual fact we know that Anwar was and is a close ally of the IMF. Michael Candesis is the chairman of the IMF, and Anwar Ibrahim, unfortunately, is a close ally of his, and they're jointly writing a book. So here we have the power behind Al Gore, Bill Clinton, and the whoever else comes into the White House are always Karun or Ibn Karun. From the time of Musa alayhi salam, it's the same mentality, the same people, the same power mongers who wish to control everything and everybody. But they will fail, because Rasulullah said, when they fail, they cannot bring the whole world under its control through their machinations, their fitna, and their secret societies and all the things that they do, they will not succeed. But the opposite side to that is that they will bring about the world's destruction. So we have to do something now to understand how we got here and how we're going to get out of it, or at least defend ourselves. And again, things are never what they appear to be. Many of the brothers from the Middle East who are here, and some others probably, will be aware of this man, Miles Copeland, who wrote a number of very important books, The Game of Nations, and this is an extract from his autobiography, The Game Player. And I met him in Birmingham, just on the eve of the Gulf War. And he said, basically, after I had a discussion with him, he said, when Muslims start to wake up to what's happened, then we'll have a problem. But at the moment, they're all asleep and we don't have a worry. When Alan Dulles was in head of the CIA station chief in Egypt, and Anthony Eden was trying to kill Nasser, Nasser was giving lots of anti-American speeches. But those speeches were written by Miles Copeland and the CIA staff, and this gave the illusion that Nasser was anti-American. So whoever is speaking in anti-American or anti-British or anti-this, maybe it's the exact opposite that's going on. Because he said, basically, we understood, as Nasser did at the time, that the new regime's hold on the country depended on it being consistently and convincingly anti-American, because America was taking over the British Empire by a number of means, and this was the deal. So, as with Saddam Hussein, for a number of years, maybe 8 to 10 years, he was the close ally of George Bush, or the Burning Bush, as he's known. And so things are rarely what they appear to be. The other bit that I was wanting This was the other extension of the Russian Revolution from Coyle's Masonic Encyclopedia. And he was saying that basically the lodges were composed almost wholly of foreigners and high Russian aristocrats, and that they were not disturbed by the police. The first orders attempting to fill the place vacated by the Masonic lodges were political societies. So he's saying here that in May 1908, the Grand Orient of France constituted three lodges in St. Petersburg, and this is just prior to the lodges taking over in Turkey. So this is, the eye must be kept on the ball that it's finance predominantly to do with Rothschild, Rockefeller, Schiff, Kuhn and Loeb. These are the ones, Ibn Karun, the ones who have basically created all the problems, and all the wars have been for their objectives, which are certainly never in the interests of the people. There is a famous or infamous map, basically. This is the program mapped out by Herzl. Turkey fell in 1908. Cairo, basically, Egypt, Saudi Arabia, Basra, Iraq, those countries, basically, that were taken over by groups that were, in appearance, may have been Muslim, but their behavior, ad-din mu'amala, or as Isa alayhi salam would say, by their fruits you will know them. This basically has been completed. This is, and if you look at the flag of Israel, you will see the two blue stripes, the one on the top, the one on the bottom, and with the hexagram, the star of David Alroy, not the star of David alayhi salam. And who can tell me what the flag of Israel represents? Is anybody here? Can tell me what the two blue stripes constitute? Sorry? Nile to the Euphrates, correct. So this has happened. Wherever you had then Michel Aflac, the socialist movements came, the false belief, the fitna and the false belief, socialism, whatever ism it was the thing that destroyed the Arabs, nationalism, and the hatred that came about was as a result of the stupidity of the Muslims in actually following Iblis with one of his different hats on. They say the genius of Satan is he convinces half the world he doesn't exist and the other half that they're not being influenced by him. So Iblis is always very active in deception. Now, so the New World Order, you heard that expression. We ought to at least mention it tonight, as it's on the agenda. I have here a document. It is basically, there are 80 pages, and it is the National Security Memorandum 200. Now, the New World Order, all this has been brought about, all this machination is to bring about the New World Order. And as I said to the brothers on many occasions, remember, following every new world order, there's a new world invoice, and the price has been very high. The National Security Memorandum was written by George Bush, Henry Kissinger, who signed it, and the third party is Grant Scowcroft. And if I show you that here we have, this is Time magazine, Newsweek, July the 14th, a big US build-up in the Gulf, okay? But it was July 1980. The Gulf War was rehearsed, set in motion to bring about the New World Order. It's in Newsweek. Everything, unfortunately, as Roosevelt said, remember, nothing happens by accident. It was a risky strategy, but it was called the Carter Doctrine that was being implemented, which was to put a ring of steel around the oil fields and bring about the control. Now, the New World Order, you have to look at people such as Kissinger, who is a very important player. But in this document, which was signed in 1974, they're calling for the depopulation of certain countries by economic means where possible, by military means where necessary. 13 countries are earmarked for depopulation. As part of that program, remember that George Bush, Brent Scowcroft and that group, George Bush's father and grandfather were founding members of the eugenics movement, the race hygiene lobby, the group that actually brought Hitler to power and depressed the economy in Europe to bring about, through the ballot box, the Nazi movement. This was all carefully orchestrated, because not until 1913, when the Federal Reserve was established, were the means for global control of economies. But getting rid of the useless eaters is one of the expressions that George Bush uses in this document. And he says that the menace of human population has to be curbed. And the calling for a virus to be developed, they were calling, this was in 69, looking for a virus that might achieve the objective of culling or reducing populations. It's even the World Health Organization specified the search for a virus that would attack T cell function as opposed to B cell. And it all comes out of this system, beginning with Hizb ul-Shaytan, because there's no other explanation. If you know the Masonic system and how people and what they worship, in the seventh degree they invoke an entity called Jabalon Jehovah. It's on the front of this book, which I call Satanic Voices, Ancient and Modern. And Iblis is then invoked by a name that people think that they're invoking Allah or a divine force, but in actual fact they're invoking Iblis. Jehovah, Yahuwah, Jabalon. Bull, his name's Baal, and this is the Lord of On. And those, anybody from Egypt, from Misa here? Well, if you've been to Heliopolis, to Ain Shams, or to On, there's a little place in Cairo called On, just inside the Heliopolis. That's where Yusuf was taken when he was taken captive. And there is a Mesela, an obelisk, or a Shiva Lingam, for those who are more familiar with that expression. And the whole system is about the worship of Shiva Lingam, or the phallic worship, solar phallic worship. And the system we're looking at is one that is not at all divinely inspired. But if any of you have a dollar bill, a single dollar bill, you can look on the back and you'll find all the symbols of Pharaoh and Namrud and the system which basically has brought this about. So what I'd like you to do, I'm going to pass this round if anybody's got one, but at least have a look at it. You see on the back of the single dollar, the system of Shaitan al-Kabir is writ large, and this is a Federal Reserve note. Remember, the Federal Reserve is an illegal body under the American Constitution. It is totally illegal. So you have there the symbols of Iblis and the symbols of oppression on this dollar bill. And we are all Abdullahi, as the Turkish say, we're slaves of the dollar. So this control mechanism through Riba is the mechanism that the New World Order controls us through, which is why we can't have an Islamic bank in Saudi Arabia. One would have assumed that there would be a place, but it is illegal to open an Islamic bank in Saudi Arabia, or Saudi America, as somebody called it earlier today. So the key is in the power of money, and until we wake up to the fact that we are powerless unless we control the means of distribution which Allah has given us. And Imam Ghazali explained 1,000 years before Keynes even understood, or David Ricardo understood money, the key is for us is to recognize that we are our worst enemy, and we point the fingers at others, but when we point the finger, there are always three pointing back at us. We are in this condition because we have been taken over by stealth. Tipu Sultan in India, for instance, had almost defeated the British, and Napoleon, remember, Napoleon converted to Islam in 1798. His abolition of riba in France and in the Empire was the key to why we had to prevent his success at the Battle of Waterloo. We published last year in Malaysia Napoleon and Islam, a translation of a book in which Napoleon, once he saw the threat, saw the debt of France, which is like if anybody doing chemotherapy or cancer studies, you'll find that the cancer eventually becomes an exponential. Riba mirrors exactly the conditions of cancer in the body. And so we'll see that this foot and mouth outbreak is all related to riba, because we're killing the animals because we wish to have a clear record for exporting, and we get a premium. So it's all down to money. But the information for you to take away is that to export is not the best thing at all. It is the very worst thing you can do. You should only export what is surplus, because everybody's trying to import and export and gain a positive balance of trade. But Napoleon understood it, that riba, because as Professor Palmerton, if I give him a chance to talk, will mention that he recognized in Spain, when he read Al-Muqaddima of Ibn Khaldun, there is virtually no reference to riba. So the key for the golden age for Jews, Christians and Muslims is that there was an absence of riba. If there is a presence of riba, it is impossible to have peace. Impossible. Even if you pray five times a day, you fast 11 months of the year, you will have fitna and war because Allah does not allow it. So, Spain, the 600 years there, the secret is la riba, no interest, no bunga, fais, whatever you wish to call it. But that is the key to undoing all the peace. So Napoleon recognized it, and he said when he saw the debt of France growing, he said, it is amazing that this monster interest has not devoured all humanity. It would have done so long ago had not bankruptcy and revolution acted as counterpoison. So he, Napoleon, Jacob Schiff, Rothschild, that group, the same family, Ibn Karun, had to get the British army to go and defend them and their system. And unfortunately, Napoleon lost. Napoleon lost, and that was the great tragedy for Europe. It was the first round of Maastricht. He wanted a common currency and recognized that riba was destroying Europe, and Europe would have no peace till it abolished the system, which is why he had to go, and we ensured that with pulling on all the strings, we managed to defeat him. But what the threat was to Britain, and the caricatures and the cartoons of the day were showing Napoleon turning Turk, and he was considered then to be a threat for spreading the democratic faith. So Islam was viewed as a threat because it was viewed as being democratic. So let's get back and do our history and not accept that the history that we've been given is definitely written by the victors, written by those who have no interest in liberating people but just enslaving us. So I think I've taken up enough of your time. I'd like to call on Professor Palmerton to add and say what he would like to say. We've travelled extensively Pakistan, we've been in Egypt and in Sudan. We've looked at the system there, and of course with Turkey, what's happening there. What we advised 10 years ago, what we suggested, of course, was not accepted in Sudan or elsewhere, and they've suffered the consequences. Just one final point. It was that only one man in the Sudan understood what we were saying, and he was a man called Hassan Safi from Shamail Bank. And he said what we were saying was true, that what they've tried to do is put an Islamic tarbush on the British system, and it is irredeemable. Thank you very much. Assalamu alaikum.
Thank you, David. Assalamu alaikum. As usual, it doesn't leave me much to say, and not much time to say it in, but you may well wonder why it is that a Christian comes to address a predominantly Islamic or Muslim audience. The reason is that, in fact, faith in God, Allah, is one. We share a tradition which goes right back as far as the God of Abraham. What unites us is huge in agreement. What divides us is tiny. David and I met quite some time ago at a by-election where I was fighting for my own particular party. David was standing, and I picked up his manifesto, and he referred to a little town in Austria called Wörgl. And I thought, well, what do these funny Muslims know about Wörgl? You know, they all come from the subcontinent. What do they know about Austria? Well, eventually, of course, I found David and we started to talk, and we discovered that we shared one particular interest. That is, that we both recognized that what Allah in the Quran and God in the Torah, that is what we Christians call the Old Testament, about riba, usury, was a predominant factor in the condition which we human beings were in. God, Allah, had each and every one of us born into a world of abundance. He promised us this. The Quran is full of it. The Bible, the Injil and the Torah is also full of this, about abundance. He's given us everything here for our need. If that's true, why are the children of Ethiopia, why are the people of Malaysia dying for the want of material things? There are now in this world enough of us to provide from the abundance that God, Allah, has given us everything for our need. Why then is there still poverty? Why then is there still suffering? If you go back to our sacred texts, and in particular the Quran, there is one thing we are told which, if we practice, we will challenge God, Allah, and He will visit war upon us. Riba. You may say, well, yeah, but we live in a world where everything is concerned with riba. Yeah, that's right. And we also live in a world where there is no peace. You may well say, well, how come this very simple mechanism, in fact, causes all this problem? Well, it's actually quite simple. And it's very understandable that if you are the sort of person, and I think between Muslims and Christians we agree, that human beings have the capacity not only for good, but the capacity for evil. And we have a choice. God, Allah, gives us that choice. There are people who are prepared to listen to that funny fella who whispers on your shoulder and says, you know, these things are all right, mate. You can be better than anybody else. You can do all these things. And there are people who are prepared to listen to the devil. Now, that's a very unpopular word to use, especially in the year 2001. People generally look at you and think, well, this man must be Majnoon. He must be crazy to talk about a thing called the devil. Well, okay. There are people who are prepared to put their interests above the interests of society and above the rest of God's creation. We tend, if we're not careful, to try and demonize certain groups in society, and we do. David's mentioned groups of people who quite clearly have acted in their own interests and not in the interests of society. But wherever you find these groups of people, there is always this common factor that they command the control of money, the medium of exchange. Now, money is not God-given, it's man-made. Money is not wealth. Wealth is what God, Allah, has given us. It's all around us. It's goods and services, our ability to help each other, our ability to care for each other, our love. This is wealth. Money is not wealth like that. It's a man-made construct. But if you're this sort of person who wants personal power, you don't believe God, Allah, when He says, I've given you everything you need, you follow a creed which says, No, this world is, you know, it's a world of scarcity. And if things are scarce, I'm going to have to fight and struggle and steal from somebody else enough for me. No matter about what they have, I believe in a world of scarcity. Now, if you believe in that world of scarcity, then the greatest weapon you can have to maintain your position of dominance is to control the money system. As there are now billions of us in this world, the idea of barter, that is exchanging what surplus we've got for what surplus somebody else has got, has become too difficult. It can be done in simple societies, it can be done in small societies, but I would suggest that it's now become too difficult for us to manage this on an international scale. So we invented for ourselves this marvellous concept called money, a medium of exchange. Now these people that I'm describing, who believe that they are better than the rest of us, who throughout history have talked about the New World Order, we talk about it being new now, they were talking about the New World Order 250 years ago. So this idea of a New World Order is not new, it's the plans that people have made. Now that, right at the centre of those plans is the control of money, the medium of exchange. Now as a medium of exchange, money works very well indeed. But if you allow people to treat it as a monopoly, which is what we now have allowed, because every so-called sovereign nation in this world, with very tiny exceptions, think in terms of borrowing their supply of the medium of exchange. And who do they borrow it from? They borrow it from private monopolies. We talk about the Bank of England being the government's bank. It is not. It's a private institution. The Americans talk about the Federal Reserve Bank of America being the government's bank. It is not. It is a private institution. These institutions create, out of nothing, money. Now that's a scandalous idea, until you sort of start and think about it, because there's got to be somewhere for money to come from in the first place. It is created out of nothing, and the cost of doing this is tiny. But we have been conned, almost without exception, every nation in this world have been conned into believing that the sovereign state, which is what people like myself and those who belong to the movement that I belong to claim should be the creators of our money supply in the name of us, the people, each one of these sovereign governments has been conned into believing they've got to borrow their money supply. Except, and this is where Islam comes in again, have we got any people from Pakistan here who could tell me when the Islamic Republic of Pakistan was founded? Please, what date? 14th August 1947. August 47. Yes. So what we're talking about, 54 years? Right. 50 years. So 50 years ago, a nation in this world said, we are going to have a state under God, under Allah. The rules that will apply here will be his rules. Except it didn't quite happen, did it? Because this year, you have now got a judgment that says that the giving and taking of riba is obnoxious to Islam. After 50 years. Now, go back to your Quran. There is no injunction in the Quran as serious as the injunction against riba. Expect war from Allah and his messenger if you will not give up your riba. It doesn't say that about adultery. It doesn't say that about all the other sins. Only that does it say. Expect war. So even the beautiful people of Pakistan have taken 50 years to get on the statute book that this is anathema. Because 10, 12 years ago, The Sharia court, which according to your constitution is the Supreme Court of Pakistan, somebody went to them and said, please will you give a ruling? Is riba obnoxious to Islam? The Sharia court eventually said, yes, it is. What happened? The bankers and the government appealed against God. Now, I find that quite remarkable. Last year, this hearing, this appeal, went to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court of Hanau handed down a judgment. So now we have the interesting case that a major nation in this world, actually the law of the land says that riba is haram. I'm dying to find out exactly what's going to happen about this. But you may well say, well, why is this simple thing putting all of us into slavery? Because that's what it is doing, and I'll explain to you the history about this slavery business in a minute. If these private monopolies hand out money to governments at interest, usury, riba, bunga, bais, whatever you like to call it, sooth. We got into trouble, by the way, when we was talking about Saudi Arabia. Why is it that this causes such mayhem? Well, it's very simple, and I'd like you to think about it and study it yourself, and tell me maybe next year when we come and worry you again whether you think that this is right. If these private monopolies issue, for instance, £1,000, and they want, and they are the only people who can create money, remember, and they want back 1,100, where's that other £100 come from? It's got to wait for somebody else to go to the usurer, the riba merchant, the banya, and borrow themselves to be able to, for you to get it from them to be able to pay it back. Now what that then means is escalating debt. And you've seen it throughout the whole of what we in the West call the Third World. It is strangling the world. It is killing our children. But it's worse than that. Do you know what the most indebted nation in the world is? The United States of America. So, you may well have heard of a movement called Jubilee 2000. It was very successful within a very limited area. Because 2 years ago, something like 70,000 people came to Birmingham in England and surrounded the G7 meeting and demanded that the debts of the Third World should be written off. And everybody thought they were crazy. But they weren't. That is an idea which goes back at least 5,000 years. If you read the Torah, the Christian's Old Testament, you will see the story about Jubilee. Jubilee was one of God's mercies, Allah's mercies. He knew we were going to be disobedient. He knew we were going to practice riba. And he knew what would happen when we did it. It would enslave us. And that's exactly what it does. So, if you go back to the Torah, it talks about the acceptable year of the Lord. Jubilee. Every 7 years, under that system that was handed down to us as an instruction, all debts are to be forgiven. Every 50 years, 7 times 7, the debts were to be forgiven, the slaves were to be released, because we would be enslaved, and the land that had been lost because of debt had to be returned to its original owners. Now that's in the Torah. Now there are even, you can go back even farther than Abraham on this. You can go back to Mesopotamia, Hammurabi, in his code. He knew very well that his ability to put an army in the field depended upon having free people who had a stake in the land being prepared to fight for him. Indebted people would not do that. So you can go back to Hammurabi, and he had this idea of universal debt forgiveness. So, if you come from a country and you intend to return to that country and that country is in debt, and that every country, think on as to why. You want me to talk about that?
Yeah.
All right. Think on why you're in debt. Why should you be in debt to foreigners? Have we got any Egyptians here? Because when we were in Egypt, I heard a lovely saying, which apparently goes back something like 7,000 years. The wealth of Egypt is in the hands of others. Now, why should that be? Because that applies to Pakistan too. You're not short of anything. You've got a population of genius. They're hard workers. They've got everything there for their need. Why should they be sending out of their country more than they want to take in? It does not make sense, and it is driven by riba. Now, David asked me to tell you another story.
I wanted to just mention that about the New World Order is on that dollar bill.
Oh, yes. Well, now, very interesting. Has everybody had a look at that dollar bill?
I'm waiting for it to come back.
It's only a dollar, David. It's only money. The dollar bill talks about the New World Order.
No less order, sacred order.
It's on the dollar bill. Now, why should that be? Now, I actually came to this country as a refugee. I may look white, but I come from the Channel Islands, a little group of islands to the south of England, not far from the coast of France, and I came here because of fascism. I wasn't able to go back and live permanently in Jersey, and I never knew why. The system there, you will probably tell me, if you know anything about Jersey, you'll say, oh yes, well, it's a tax haven. Well, that may well be a decent description of it now, but the reason why the Channel Islands is so different from the mainland of England is because the state, the royal courts, do not borrow. They never have borrowed, at least for 300 years to my knowledge. I haven't gone back any farther than that. The scenario goes something like this, and this could be Karachi. Yeah? There's been a storm. The seawall's been breached, and the people going bang on the door of the Parliament and say, we need a new seawall. And the Parliament will say, well, what do you want a new seawall for? And say, well, there's just been a storm and it's washing away the soil. So the people have established a need. They need a seawall. The next question would be, have we the materials? Now, if anybody's been to Jersey, the island is built of granite. So of course they've got the materials. So they've established the need, they have the materials. The next question will be, have we the labour? Now come on, I've been to Karachi. You've got plenty of labour to build a new seawall, haven't you? Yes? Better than driving taxis. So
they were driving into the seawall, that's why they
needed Oh, is that why they did it? I knew they were crazy. So, the people have established a need, they've established that they've got the material, they've established that they've got the labour. There is no rule in this common sense, no common sense rule in the whole of this world which should deny that that wall should be built. Except that they need a medium of exchange. Now, in the Channel Islands, the royal courts will say, okay, that's plenty for money. They will provide the money to a contractor who will buy the materials from the supplier of the materials, who will pay the labour of all the people, who will pay the butcher, the baker, the candlestick maker. The money will then be returned to the treasury through the taxation. The seawall will be built and paid for. It is an asset on the books, not a liability. That money was not borrowed and it didn't accrue riba. The alternatives, now where are we? We're in Leicester. So a bit north of here, there's a bridge over the River Humber, which was built, which cost £91 million to build. There was a need for it. The materials existed. The labour existed. But the money was borrowed. £91 million it cost in 1981. Right. That bridge stands on the books now as a debt of just over £500 million because the money was borrowed from a private monopoly instead of the state creating it. Now, you tell me, where's the common sense in all that? So, Why is this country deeply in debt? Why is Pakistan in debt? It's because we have failed to understand the argument and the issue concerning riba, and we cannot say we were not warned. The Quran says it: expect war from Allah and His Messenger, if you will not give up your riba. That is the mechanism that drives these people who wish to see a new world order. Thank you.
Just a point on the dollar bill. It says in Novus Ordo Secularum, the new order of ages, the new world order. And the original design was by William Barton in 1782. So that new world order has been 200 years or so coming into existence, but that has been the plan. Yes, it's a Rosicrucian design, but if you'll see from it that it says also "I pluribus unum," one nation out of many, but that's been the objective that's been worked for, and it hasn't happened overnight.
Inshallah, there will now be a short question and answer session, and there should be some brothers coming to collect the questions. First question: was World War II conspired by Masonry, or was Hitler and his canon within the movement?
Well, very interesting question. How will we ever know? If it wasn't, it should have been. As far as I know, Hitler wasn't himself a Freemason, but it didn't matter very much. The result was very nearly the same. You will find that the fingers of Freemasonry in almost all these areas of conflict.
To Dr. Pidcock, Professor Palmerton quoted the Torah regarding cancelling the debt, and what does the Quran say about this?
Sorry?
Right, okay, sorry. I've been demoted. Right, Professor Palmerton quoted the Torah regarding cancelling debt. What does the Quran say? Exactly the same, because the Quran is the culmination, the completion, the final message. And Allah says, better to forgive the debt. It said, if the debtor is in difficulty, grant him time till it is easy for him to repay, but better still to forgive the debt if you did but realize. So cancellation of debt is preferable. Now, this doesn't mean to say that if you are not in difficulty and you try and get out of the debt, because remember, if you die in debt, you cannot go to paradise. Even if you die as a shaheed, Rasulullah wouldn't pray for somebody, even though he was martyred in the battlefield, until somebody settled his debt. So it's not an option. You can think like the rabbinical argument is, well, we managed to get around that one. There is no escape. If you owe something, then you should pay it, if you can. Otherwise, the one who the debt is owed to, if he realized it, it will be far better. And this is exactly what the Torah said, and why Bani Israel got into difficulty, because they got round the prohibition.
And if you'd like to know the Christian view of this, Jesus said, lend expecting no return.
It is said that the world will be one state when the Dajjal comes. Could you please comment on this?
Be one state, yes, yes. Well, we are almost one state, in a hell of a state, really. This is what the whole purpose of the New World Order is to bring about a single world government. The United Nations is that body, because it is basically holds everyone to ransom. The New World Order and the United Nations is basically all these things, MAI, GATT, all these agreements are to control from the centre. And the bombing of Kosovo and all these things that are going on are to bomb everybody into submission. Of course, it's not going to work in the long run, but in the short term, the two world wars were for the bringing about of the State of Israel. This was part of the policy. And in this book, there is an important thing to realise, that by 1938, already the decision was made that in the next war, that to make sure America came in on our side in the Second World War, that Japan would be engineered into firing the first shot. The policy was to bring about Pearl Harbor. Well, Pearl Harbor was the key, but the week before Pearl Harbor happened, they were already discussing things in the Oval Office, Roosevelt, Admiral Stark, Marshall, and three others, basically saying, how can we maneuver Japan into firing the first shot? This was the game. It was already policy planned by British, and there's reference to it in this book. Thank you.
Is the collection of tax a better option than interest or REBA?
Forgive me, whoever asked the question, but it's avoiding the issue of where does the money come from in the first place. Because taxation does not raise revenue. It takes it from one pocket and places it in the other. It is not a revenue-raising exercise. If you need money, it has to be created. Taxation may well be a policy tool to redistribute money from one group to another, but it does not raise revenue.
When the world is controlled by money, how are we, the Muslims, supposed to fight this?
Right. Well, by coming to lectures like this, hopefully we can start, if we light the blue touch paper, and try and work out that there is a third option. What Ken is referring to is an example that Muslims should recognise in the Channel Islands, that there is a third option that works perfectly well. And Muslims, unfortunately, and not a million miles from here, many economists gather from time to time, and they never discuss the option of Muslims creating the money that they require. It's always about taxation and borrowing, but also and saving. The idea of savings being of benefit is madness, because however much people save in 1 year means that that amount of wealth has not been consumed. So each year you have a reduction in the capacity to produce, and people are then unemployed. So this is a mad system. Muslims have to go back to what Imam Ghazali described, what has been described clearly in the examples of Rasulullah, but we haven't worked it through, we haven't thought about it. But there's a perfectly good option, and it's really a matter of, do you let somebody use your pen and write the cheque for £1 million, or do you write it for yourself at zero interest? And it must be that sovereignty, the control of the creation of money, stays with Baitul Mal, with the government or the treasury or with the emir. And it is perfectly viable, as the Channel Island shows. The alternative is that you, all of us in this room, our national debt, does anybody know how much it is at the moment? Our national debt? 50 billion. No, it's 400,000 million. Right, it's more than the week's salary, even in Turkey at the moment, which you might get that much for $2. 400,000 million is what began as 1 million 300 years ago. The Channel Islands stayed out of it. They refused to relinquish the sovereignty. The Bank of England was set up to mortgage by degrees all the people, all the wealth of this country, and we're still paying interest on the loans to William of Orange. So £1 million debt is now 400,000 million, and we paid 35,000 million interest this year. That's what Gordon Brown just spent, 35,000 million as an interest payment on the national debt, which should never have existed in the first place.
But by far our greatest problem, in fact, is ignorance. We do not read, we forget our history.
Yeah, destined to revisit.
What is a Freemason?
What is an un-Freemason?
Well, there's probably about 300,000 of them in this country. Most of them are totally unaware of the sort of things that David and I have been talking about, because they are part of what is called the blue degrees, that is the first three degrees. And what is a Freemason? It's a member of this organisation, organised into lodges, most of them in those first three degrees. And if you want to say what is Freemasonry, what Freemasons themselves say is that Freemasonry is a system of morality veiled in allegory and illustrated by symbols. Now that's me telling you some of the secrets. But you know, and we know, that above those first 3 degrees, where most Freemasons are, it's a benevolent organisation, there are 30 more degrees. And as you get up through those degrees, it becomes more and more obvious that this is not an organisation worshipping God as we know it. Freemasons are told, for instance, that in their ritual, that they are building the Temple of Solomon. As soon as you get above the first 3 degrees, it becomes plainly obvious that it's not Solomon's temple that's being built, it's Nimrod's temple, Namrud. Now that changes the whole thing. It then becomes more and more obvious the farther up you get that in fact this is a satanic movement, and it is clearly for satanic ends.
Yeah, if I could just add something to that. The idea that if we study the Quran and the Hadith, and we'll find that the Quran also mentions Ad and Thamud, the people who met as an ikhwan, a brotherhood of nine. And there were nine signs of Musa alayhi salam to Pharaoh. Nine is synonymous with magic and Iblis, or the worship of the Shams. And if we know from the Quran, Allah says, in each civilization was destroyed because it worshipped the sun. The sun is, or the fire, is that which Iblis identifies with, smokeless fire, the jinn. He made of smokeless fire. And we are made of clay. And he believed that he is of a superior creation to us. And the whole system of, is actually, I show here in this book, this Brotherhood of Nine meeting, and they invoke Jehovah Jabalon, A'udzubillah. And that they meet in groups of 3 times 3. The same brotherhood that met and they conspired to kill the Prophet and then conspired to commit perjury. And you find it now with the police and many things in this country that perjury, lying, and it all comes from this spirit. So Freemasonry is to, as Allah says in the Quran, and they follow what the jinn gave out falsely against the kingdom of Suleiman. But Suleiman was not a disbeliever. It was the jinn who misled. So Suleiman was a prophet. So the key is, this is the worship of Iblis by a very subtle way. But the brotherhood, the Quran mentions them clearly, that they are a brotherhood that would not reform. And these are the same people today. We are being tested, as Allah says in Surah Ankabut, do not think you will not be tested as others before you were tested just because you say you believe. We will be tested with good and with evil, and we either submit to it or we resist it.
What about the average person and their debt, for example the students who have taken out student loans?
Are you asking what to do about it, or what should we think about it? Because quite clearly, I think the idea of bringing people into higher education at the price of debt, I think, is a mechanism for control. It is social control. You will leave this institution, if you have debts around your neck, conforming to what you're expected to believe and what you're expected to do. Who was it who said that the hand of the lender is always above the hand of the borrower? If you're in debt, always you are under someone else's control. Now you should know from your Quran that as faithful Muslims, is what you should not be. There is only one entity in this world worthy of a submission to, and that's not the moneylender.
Why do so many people believe in the interest-based economy? How can this be challenged? How can Muslim students in this country change the direction of the New World Order?
Well, how come that so many people believe it? Because it's become dominant, and we've gone to sleep. We've allowed it to become dominant. My own church, my own religious belief, in fact, is guilty of this. And, you know, having said mea culpa, I'm afraid Islam is now at the same position that Christendom was 300 years ago. Because gradually, drip by drip, the Christian churches have given way. For 1500 years, the Christian churches stood four square against Reba and said, this shall not be. But gradually, powerful people have drip. They've got control of governments, they've got control of academia, and what is taught now is not complete. We are given part of the story, and that part which tells us that these things are wrong are not being taught. Now, what can we do to get out of this, you say? I think, first of all, we need to educate ourselves as to what money is and what it is not. And there are mechanisms, there are groups of people throughout this world who are saying, we're not having this. Debt is controlling us. Debt is stopping us from having access to the wealth that we know that is there for our use and preventing us from using the labour that we have to apply to those materials. And they are starting to struggle. They're beginning to create organisations like the Let's Movement. Let's means local exchange trading schemes. Basically, groups of people have gone back to what amounts to sophisticated barter. And in this country alone, there are 500 of these little groups. Islam in this country amounts now to how many? 2 million people? It is perfectly possible for you to do what I think is probably the greatest stroke you could ever possibly do, and that is start to get your youngsters out from mortgages. It is possible, using your combined strength, to do what we, the Khawajas, did 200 years ago. If you go down the main street of any town in this country, you will see things called building societies. Now, okay, I know in the last few years most of these building societies have converted themselves into banks, but there are still building societies, and how those building societies started was groups of people just like you coming together and saying, look, we want a home. We will put our savings together to help people to buy a home. That's how our building societies started. In Pakistan, you have your committees, committee system. You could, through your mosques and your Islamic societies, actually create building societies to get your youngsters out of this mortgage trap. By the way, do you know what the word mortgage means? It's actually a Norman word. I'm a Norman. I come from Normandy, the Channel Islands. It's a word we invented. Mort, death. Gauge, grip. Mortgage, death, grip. Is that not what a mortgage is? It's haram. You, as faithful Muslims, could get yourselves out of this, as English people once did in this country. But I hope you don't do what we did, and that is forget. Because that's what's happened to Christendom. We forget. You still remember. But you're at the point now where, if you're not careful, you have academics within Islam who are saying that because money now is notional money, it doesn't matter if you have interest Reba on it. It doesn't matter. They're sinking you. Just as Christendom lost its influence because it lost its way, we forgot. You don't have to.
About the seven gates in Medina, does this mean Dajjal has appeared, or will it be demolished before he comes?
Well, according to the hadith that I quoted, if everything else in the hadith is accurate and came true according to the prediction, the prophecy of Rasulullah, then I think we probably haven't realized that Dajjal is here. I mean, the system is in place. How many more Lebanons do we want? How many more Rwandas? How many more situations do we want to see, like in Palestine, where there's been the mass extermination of people? I mean, 200-300 million people in the last century, 64 million in China exterminated. I mean, this is a system that the four horsemen of the apocalypse from the book of Revelations are already, they've been out and they're on the way back. So I think the Muslims have missed the fact that the Turks, who I spoke to in Turkey on the 500th anniversary of the conquest of Constantinople, were totally unaware of the Young Turk Revolution and what it was. So if they've missed that, Dajjal, the system is already in place. Christianity is here, but Isa alayhi salam isn't, but we know he's still alive, but we can't see him. He's not in view, but all the system, everything is in place. What does Rasulullah say? That when the when women dominate, when human blood has no value, when riba dominates, these are signs when children have disobeyed the parents. All this has come about when a man will speak at one side of the world and someone at the other will respond. Everything's in place. The Muslims, unfortunately, have been asleep for 500 years. And like the sleepers in the cave, they're still, you know, wondering. And but I'm sure that if the conquest of Constantinople, the Palestine, 1917, the Balfour Declaration was written immediately after the fall of Constantinople. Everything is in place. The United Nations, everything's there. So all we have to do, but what would we do if we saw Dajjal with one eye? We'd probably say, oh yeah, great, you know, we wouldn't respond. And the fact that we haven't hated this system in our hearts is the reason why we're suffering the way we are. I have no doubt in my own mind that this system of Dajjal is here. We've had nearly 100 years of it, and it's up to us, and we will get the government we deserve until we change what's in ourselves. The riba, and riba is the control mechanism, because Allah says, or Rasulullah says, that when Dajjal comes, riba will dominate. It is now totally dominant. The whole world is under control. So we have to wake up to the fact that we may not have seen him, but we've certainly seen the system.
This question's for Professor Palmerton. Giving a brief background of yourself, what was the defining moment in seeing the light, and were you in any way pressured after you left the Freemasons?
In all fairness, there was no conversion on the road to Damascus, for those of you who know it was a gradual understanding over a long period of time, starting from a gut feeling that there was something wrong. As a Christian, we have actually one formal prayer, which we call the Lord's Prayer, and part of that says, give us this day our daily bread. Now, if we believe in God, in Allah, then that's what he's done. If that's what we pray, why are there our children dying of starvation? There has got to be something wrong, and that was where I started from. There's got to be something wrong. David talked about there's got to be a better way. Well, I wasn't quite like that. But over a whole period of time, gradually things began to fall into place as I studied. I didn't know why it was that I couldn't go home to Jersey because I couldn't afford the price of the property there. I didn't know why all the rich people wanted to go and live there. The climate's good, but it ain't that good. It's not as good as Karachi. But eventually, a group of my fundamentalist Christian friends, because David and I constantly talk about fundamentalism, one of our wishes is to put the fund back into fundamentalism.
And the fund.
And the fund. And they put to me an argument about Freemasonry, about the oaths that a Freemason swears. And of course, the Bible, Injil, says quite clearly, forswear not thyself. In other words, don't swear oaths like this. And it didn't match up. I looked again at my Freemasonry and I said, you're right, I've got to come out. And there's a bit of a side issue. They said, well,
sort of lies.
Yeah, they said, well, come on, you've got to make joining Freemasonry, progressing through the degrees, was a matter of ceremony. There were ceremonies for this and ceremonies, and there were some of them great. They're quite fun, actually. We're going to have a ceremony. And I said, well, what do you mean? You're going to have to burn your regalia. Well, I came to the point and said, yeah, well, okay, we'll have to have a ceremony. Now, one of my friends lives in a lovely stone cottage up in the Pennines, and he's got one of these log-burning stoves with a stovepipe going up there like that. So we called a meeting of some of my friends, and I brought all my regalia, and they said, well, come on, you're going to have to burn your father's as well. Now, strangely enough, burning my father's regalia actually was more difficult than doing my own. So it all went into the log stove, we set it on fire, and it damn near burnt his cottage down. the pipe got red hot. And they said, there you are, there's the devil going up the chimney. Now, I don't know whether that's true, but it's a good story. Now, have I had any problems since? I'm waiting for the next shoe to drop. No, I haven't, in all honesty. I don't know why. Well, I've got enough trouble with you, Muslim. Yeah, that's quite right. From the oath that you swear, coming out is not considered possible. All sorts of things are supposed to happen to you. They haven't. So the answer to the question is, no, I haven't personally had any trouble. But I tell you what, there was a man called Calvi. Now, I don't know whether that name means anything to you. But he was a high-ranking mason. I was only a master mason, you know, one of the proles. Calvi was an Italian, belonged to an Italian lodge, very high up, one of their banking fraternity, and they actually hung him under Hungerford Bridge in London. Blackfriars Bridge. Now, that is exactly according to ritual as to what happens. Above high water mark, and all these sort of things, and all the things they found in his pockets were all part of. So, clearly, certain people do suffer if they transgress. I'm waiting for it, yes. Maybe somebody's protecting me.
Freemasonry is suggested to be the forerunner to the job. Could you please comment?
The forerunner to the job. Well, it's certainly part of the Dajjal system, and it's one of the mechanisms that are used. Now, I don't thoroughly understand what Islam means by Dajjal, but we have a thing within Christendom we call the Antichrist, which I think is something very similar.
Dajjal.
In
Aramaic, yes.
It is the same, isn't it? Yeah. Right. It's certainly part of the way in which he operates in this world. I don't think there's any doubt about that.
How can the Americans be allowed to put Freemasonry sign on the $1 bill and get away with it?
Right. Well, if you are in control, you can do anything you want. As William Gladstone said about the Bank of England, from becoming the banker's bank, it has become the government's government. But this has come about over nearly 200 years. The original design was done by William Barton. And the dollar had originally, it wasn't an eagle but a phoenix that was actually the symbol on the back. But the Federal Reserve is the government of America. The Bank of England is the government of this country. So Karun and Ibn Karun are in complete control, so they can put on it whatever they want. The point being is that if people are ignorant of what it means, then of course they don't realize what the symbols represent. But here we have the Singhal appears. People will say that he has one eye now, with the Ayn Shams, and hence Ayn Shams University probably. The eye of the sun is what they worship. And this civilization, as Allah says in the Quran, they were highly sophisticated, but they worship the sun. And this system is no different. It is the original system from Babylon, from Namrud till now, it's exactly the same. So if you have the power to create money, you have the power to control everything, army, navy, air force, the lot. You are in control once you control the money. As Rothschild said, permit me to issue a nation's currency, and it matters not who makes its laws.
Is it safe, by the way, to assume that everybody knows what we're talking about when we talk about Karun?
Karun.
Yeah. Because it's rather interesting, in actual fact. Moses, spent this time up the mountain being given instructions. He came back with the instructions. And he hadn't even got down the mountain when there they were, worshipping the golden calf under the instruction of Karun, the banker. So right from the very beginning of our beliefs, there's been this fight between those who want to control money, the golden calf, and there are very interesting stories about this golden calf, Baal, because the Bank for International Settlements is in Baal. It's built like the Tower of Babel. You know, it just gets too close. So, Karun, This system has been with us for a long time, and it's part of the struggle, the jihad, that we're expected to take part in.
You'll not be able to see it from there, but this is a picture of the Bank of International Settlements in Basel. Now, Basel in Switzerland means exactly Basel, as in the golden calf. This tower is built on 19 floors, Tisat Asherah. There are 19 floors, and it is built. Now, it was interesting, I went there for the center. Basically, it was the Refa Party in Turkey organized a conference to commemorate the first Baal Convention held there by Herzl in the establishing of the State of Israel. But interestingly, I noticed, although unfortunately my camera wasn't a brilliant camera, this is the center, this is the bank. Now, during the war, America, Britain, Germany, Italy, all the heads of the banks were still meeting there during the entire period of the war. And the founding of the Americans, everybody were travelling through Europe during the entire period of the war, and Hitler's banker, Hilmar Schacht, Churchill had to order the governor of the Bank of England to break off communications 2 years after war commenced. They were still in communication. So, and they threatened him with hanging. So the bankers, Karoun, is all powerful. He can put whatever he wants on his money. But what was interesting on this day was that I went and I saw, after a while, a buzzard, a large hawk, circling. It was a vulture. And then eventually three started to circle around the top of it. And this is a sequence of photographs. I thought, what an appropriate thing for this building, because this is the government, this is the bank of all banks. And this is where the power lies, where all the fortunes of the world are determined, in that building. So nothing happens by accident, it's all by design. And unfortunately, well, it's time for the Muslims to wake up. You have all the information. Nothing's been left out of what Rasulullah left us till Yawm al-Qiyamah. Our weakness is we went to sleep. So the answers are with you already. And what Rasulullah said when he got to Medina, he said, we cannot operate in this market. Our job is to establish our own market. And it's within our power to do it.
Is it true that Freemasons try to influence members of the public with subliminal messages, and do they propagate evil?
Attempt to influence members of the public? No, Freemasons generally try to keep themselves to themselves. You can't go and knock on the door and say, please can I join? You have to be invited. But they certainly attempt to influence tiers of government. And there's no doubt about this. It is well understood and it's well documented throughout the world.
Unfortunately, we've run out of time for any more questions. Inshallah, there will be refreshments available now for the brothers. It will be at the front, and for the sisters in the prayer room. If brothers want to leave, they could leave from the front of the room, and sisters from the back of the room.